One day, 30 years ago, Christmas came in July. I'll explain how this happened, but there's a backstory you'll need. It involves my older sister, who had a habit of staging family plays. If you don't know about family plays, let me help you. The family play arises from an older sister's need to be a leading lady. Ideally, this sister will come fully equipped with a thespian streak and a flair for costumes. So back in 1966, when I was 4 years old, my sister pressed her siblings into a performance of Moses and the Bulrushes. Obviously, Moses seems a little out of place for a Christmas story, but stick with me and you'll see how this goes. Of all the Bible stories, Moses and the Bulrushes, for a leading lady, is a better choice than, oh, let's say, Joshua fit the Battle of Jericho, which is too violent. Jonah jumps ship, as I recall, has no female roles. So Moses and the Bulrushes, it was. My two-year-old brother was cast as the Bulrushes, which never have any lines to deliver, but they're essential props in this play, which we all know because we've seen baby Charlton Heston in The Ten Commandments, and there were Bulrushes. And we had a large basket to put Charlton in, and my role was to be an Egyptian soldier. My costume, designed by the director and leading lady, was a towel wrapped around what back in the day were variously referred to as whitey-tighties or bun huggers. Who knows what Egyptian soldiers wore under their bath towels? Probably not much, because the Nile River Valley is a swelteringly hot place. And unlike my brother, the Bulrushes, I did have a line to deliver. In fact, I was instructed to say it over and over again, in a rhythmic sort of cadence like this. The king orders all baby boys in the land to be killed. The king orders all baby boys, and on and on. But I had not yet turned 5, so my voice was high and squeaky, and I could not have instilled fear in anyone. But I did have a large toy sword to brandish, and after double-checking my towel to be sure it was secure, I would hoist both arms high in the air, sword in one hand, march about and deliver my ominous lines. But what's more, the blocking for this play required that I move repeatedly in and out of a closet while making the proclamation to give the impression that not a single Egyptian soldier was spreading Pharaoh's decree throughout the land, but that throngs of Egyptian soldiers were threatening the poor people of Moses. They were not yet the people of Moses, because Moses was just the babe in the bulrushes. He was, in fact, as I remember, a doll missing an eye, which to my youthful way of thinking was a thing down in Egypt because we subscribed to National Geographic and I had seen the bust of Nefertiti. That is the backstory. So forward now to 1990. I'm almost 30. It was a hot July afternoon, Christmas far from my mind. I was walking home through a neighborhood between the hospital and the utilities building, and out on the sidewalk, in plain view for all the world to see, was an older sister and a family play in full swing. Three youngsters marched, not in perfect synchrony, but rhythmically, each holding some object before them. I slowed to watch this procession. The youngest held a pie tin with marbles rolling around and making a bit of a ruckus. The second child, clearly tempted to dribble, was carrying a basketball. But I had heard the older sister already shouting correctives, so he held it dutifully as though it were no mere basketball, but crown jewels resting on a velvety pillow with tassels. And last of all, maybe a 7-year-old with a broom held vertically before him, arms fully outstretched, he marched like a Scottish Highlander holding a mace. Now, as I got closer, I detected fatigue in the youngest child, who hadn't yet lost his marbles, but he was truly flagging. I told you it was a very hot July, and I should also tell you that all three of the younger siblings were wearing regal-looking bathrobes, and there was some sweat glistening on their brows. I surmised the older sister had been rehearsing them for some time before I got there. And then the pie tin began to sag lower and lower, and the little guy was almost ready to spill them all, and they would have scattered toward the street gutter. But the sister bellowed out just as I was about to pass them all, "Get that frankincense up!" I smiled to myself, remembering my travails as a soldier in the land of Egypt and all the old Bible stories and the high drama these hold for those who know and love them. For these little kids, there was still some magic to be found in putting a personal touch on their own vision of the Magi, those three kings or wise men of yore, and the odd gifts those children bore and tried to hold high in the air in a procession toward Bethlehem.